We all ready. Okay. So as far as I can see, we have 70 viewers now on Facebook. And so good evening, everyone. A very warm welcome to all the participants of the AI Basics for Schools MOOC. Welcome to our second live event. My name is Ariana, and I'm going to moderate this event. Along with my colleagues from European SchoolNet, Eugenia and Tommaso. And we are very, very pleased to have two distinguished guest speakers tonight with us. Professor Teemu Roos from Finland and Marco Neves from Portugal. Professor Teemu Roos is a computer science professor at the University of Helsinki and lead instructor of the Elements of AI course. And Marco Neves is a computer science teacher and CEO of the Interact Ideas company, which aims to bring AI to teachers and students across Europe. Tonight, we are going to talk about AI in the classroom, its benefits and challenges. And as I said, I'm really delighted and honored to have you with us tonight. Teemu, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ariana, and other organizers. Thanks very much for inviting me. It's my pleasure to join you. Tonight, it's already dark here in Finland, but what better way to spend the evening than with you? I will try to share my screen to be able to show you some material. Are you seeing the slides? Okay.
Everybody's yes.
Nodding?
Okay. Yes.
Excellent. Thank you. So, as Ariana introduced, my name is Teemu Roos. I'm from the University of Helsinki and the Finnish Center for AI. I'm a computer science professor. I teach AI and machine learning and related topics at the at the computer science department to our data science and computer science students. Mostly, of course, we have minor subject students, but as such, I am not a teacher by training. I'm a computer scientist, and my experience in teaching has been in the capacity of an amateur in teaching. So I hope you'll accept some non-teacher terminology and perhaps approaches here. Anyways, I have been teaching at the university for over a decade, but recent years we've been focusing on open education aimed at the general public, and that's what I wanted to talk about, and that's what I would like to discuss tonight, how to take contents and topics like this to the general public and also children and in schools. Right, so the backdrop of why and how I got involved in open education is in the Finnish artificial intelligence strategy that was launched in 2017, and it has some I would like to think special or almost unique aspects in its emphasis on the applications of AI, not so much on the, I mean, of course there is a focus on expertise and cutting edge research and development and innovation, but it also has a fair share of points that highlight the use of AI and the applied side of things, so to speak, and they are based on adoption of AI, on having as broad adoption of artificial intelligence in the society and in the industry, in our lives as possible, and also emphasizing different and new collaboration modes. So maybe some roles taken by certain actors, like maybe companies in education or universities in open training programs and so on and so forth, and also sort of course doing things together. So this is what the AI strategy in Finland really called for, and they asked us to sort of open up the knowledge that has been accumulating at the universities to the general public and the society. So we started doing that. The motivation that we want really sort of embraced and shared with the Finnish AI strategy was that we wanted to demystify, so get rid of the myths and the hype when there is only talk and no content. So we, of course, that is something that that we try to get past and beyond at the university in the first place, but we also wanted to sort of help the general public get a similar opportunity to get beyond the myths, so that they could take part in, you know, the very basic democratic decision making process where you have a public discourse and you formulate your opinion, and then you by whatever means you choose, you try to be active and nudge and push the society to the direction that you see the best, based on your own personal subjective opinion, but based on still that being based on facts rather than maybe myths or hype. And that we felt is very, very important from even like from fundamental democratic grounds and for the society overall. And therefore, I would even claim that we would sort of reach a narrative and reach a conclusion that when we are thinking of how to take and adopt AI in the society, it's really not so much about the kind of the technical detail, the innovations that we need to make and build better systems, but they're also political. And I will maybe get back to them in the discussion about how AI is actually sort of a fundamentally societal issue, and addressing some of the harms is really something that we need, for which we need a multidisciplinary approach, not only engineering. And therefore, we felt that this is something that the general public really would benefit from. Okay, so how we felt that we would go about with this. Of course, we were training to begin with experts and multi-skilled students at the university, and they will eventually go out into the society and have an impact there. But we felt that that's rather slow way of having people kind of on board the development. So we felt that everybody should actually reach out in a much wider sense that they've been doing. Not only training university students, but talking to the general public and talking to the press. Of course, then we'd need the press also to be aligned with this goal, and maybe getting rid of some of the hype that the press has a tendency to add on top of things to sell their newspaper or online media. So that doesn't go a lot, sort of so well with our goal. And overall, we'd really like you and everyone really to be more critical. So of course, I would say also that you should be now listening to me with a critical attitude and sort of making your own judgments about what I'm saying, whether what I'm saying is right or not. And that's of course like, once again, sort of something that is inherently a part of the academic, mindset. But we wanted to take that along with the AI content and then offer that attitude to the along with the education that we're opening up. And all of this is sort of based on education, on knowledge and skills that we wanted to offer to everyone on all levels all ages and people in all walks of life, so to speak. Okay, and what we did in concrete terms is what you have probably seen in the background materials if you looked at them, namely the course Elements of AI. And you can, you know, if you haven't seen it, I encourage you to take a quick look at the www.elementsofai.com. It's completely free. You can just browse the content as much as you like, even without signing up. If you want to see the exercises or start working on the course, then you'll need to sign up. But that's also sort of a few clicks away and doesn't cost anything. It's really sort of worth highlighting that this was a collaboration between a government-funded university, University of Helsinki, and a private company called Reactor, who are a software consultancy or software development company, and they jumped at the same opportunity to basically offer AI knowledge to the Finnish population. So we started in 2018. It's almost 3 years ago now. And by now we've had 644,000 participants and more. We opened it up to other countries as well, not only Finland. It was in English to begin with. Now we have multiple languages. And almost any country in the world you could name. And we have signups from there. And it's really aimed for the general public. So this is not a computer science course. This was sort of for me, a new experience teaching AI or teaching computer science related topics without, assuming that the learner would know coding or you know, maths that are kind of beyond the basic arithmetics. So instead of the usual, like the way I would normally teach at the university, trying to train people to build AI systems, we would actually here in the course train people what we call AI literacy. So basically being able to, once again, be critical about what you read in the media, understanding basic concepts that are even like some of the underlying concepts, not properly, like not strictly, I suppose, AI, but more like more broadly statistical thinking, what it means to appreciate statistical uncertainty. There's even some things related to medical testing, which has turned out to be quite a timely topic now with the pandemic. There's some, we explain then like how machine learning goes a few steps further than that, but still sort of in understandable terms, and things like neural networks we talk about on a conceptual level, not on the kind of fine detail under the hood. And one big thing that we discuss in the course is the societal implications of AI. So going back to the point I made about the somewhat like political, well, actually societal aspects of AI adoption, AI solutions being applied in the society, and that's one of the sort of key points that we want to make. I will basically skip this, but just to, I can't help mentioning that the course is now rated the best, the highest rated course in artificial intelligence or computer science. In a platform called Class Central, where they have something like tens of thousands of courses. Right, so I mentioned that we have multiple language versions, so we wanted to get rid of the kind of language barrier in terms of people being able to understand topic. And we have something like 20 language versions by now, or maybe more. I don't have all the flags here. But we have, yes, English, Finnish, Swedish, Estonian, German, Danish, Latvian, Lithuanian, French, Belgian, that comes in French and Flemish languages, Maltan, Irish, Polish, and then so on and so forth. And this is made possible by the Finnish EU presidency and the government of Finland, who are offering or kind of covering the expenses of the EU-wide launch. One thing that I'm particularly happy about is that we have a really wide range of different and diverse people learning about AI on the course. So not the maybe the not the kind of somewhat male dominated and sort of dominated by young men, especially tech you know tech scene or tech community that one might get in some other courses. So this kind of demonstrates that the topic is interesting to all people, all kinds of people, as long as you don't frame it in a sort of narrowly aimed style. We also have now a follow-up course, which includes some programming exercises, but that is still doable by, for instance, high school students. So there's a lot of high school students taking the follow-up course. And here, you know, one of the things to highlight is that we really, at that point, taking the follow-up course starts to sort of enable people to actually contribute to the AI community. You know, once again, AI is going to have a big impact. AI already has made a big impact in the society, and we'd like anybody at all to be able to somehow make their mark, somehow influence the way AI is being applied. And this is, you know, one small step on that path, at least. So we hope. So just to summarize, I won't, you know, give a long lecture. Not right now, at least. But I'll just summarize by saying that, in my view, AI is really something that is for everyone, and we'd really like to make, you know, our best effort to make it welcome, make it welcoming to everyone as well, so that people could learn it, you know, have a bit of fun with it, and then formulate their opinion about it. I don't like to, you know, lecture to people and tell them that, yeah, okay, AI is a good thing, or I don't want to lecture about AI is a bad thing. That is up to people to decide. People have different values. They can have different opinions, but I'd like to offer them the ability to be critical about what other people are saying, and then formulate their own, let's say, educated opinion about it. And I really hope that people by that, be their opinion negative or positive, or a mixture of both, I would like to sort of encourage people to feel that they must be active, and they can get involved, and they can change the way AI and the world is going forward. And that's sort of trying to make people more active, I think, is the sort of the cornerstone of how we designed the course and how we kind of try and promote it to as many people as possible. Just today, we announced the first pilot version of the course that we're going to launch in the University of Nairobi in Kenya. So just really recent news for you about where this initiative is going. And I'd really like to welcome everybody to first, of course, take a look at the course, and in case you sort of feel that that's something that that you want to join our mission, then everybody is welcome to do so. We've got multiple different partnership or collaboration or you know collaboration options for individuals and organizations. So I think this is sort of what I want to leave you with at this point. To invite you to be in touch and see how we could work together and make a bigger splash in making AI everyone's business and everyone's matter. That's all I had. I'll be happy to take questions at the end, but for now, thanks for your attention.
Thank you so much, Teemu, for this fantastic presentation, and also huge congratulations on such an amazing achievement with elements of AI, and especially with elements of AI going to Africa and really, really reaching out to people all over the world, because I also absolutely agree that it is important that people understand what it is, that they get acquainted with it, get familiar with it, and then decide how and what they can do to make this world even better with the help of AI, and critically approach it, of course. And that's why we also have launched this course on the, for teachers, so that teachers, that we reach out to teachers and then they can implement it in the classroom. So I'm sure there are a lot of questions that our participants have for you, but I would now like to invite Marco to share his presentation and tell us more about AI in the classroom. So what teachers can do in the classroom. Marco, the floor is yours.
I was mute. Okay. Now I think you can hear me and you can see my presentation. Okay, great. First of all, thank you very much. It's a huge pleasure to be here and to be here with Teemu and the presentation of elements of AI. That is really an amazing work in the way to spread about artificial intelligence for everyone. I will focus more here in the question of AI in education and mainly with some examples in terms of the classroom. I will just like to begin before us talk about particular in AI in education. And I think that is also something that you already have been discussed and addressed on this MOOC. We have this understand that we're talking about AI today and mainly about machine learning and this statistical approach, but there are also other areas of AI. And so this is just having in mind to give this big picture in terms when we are talking about artificial intelligence. And even today, there is many interesting discussions about the different approach of AI and the path that should be followed in terms of developing an AI. Just to give you this the big picture here in terms of the ecosystem of AI. Moving more in terms of AI and education, and my mainly occupation is a teacher, and then I teach on a high school, and I have the huge pleasure to be with students every day and also trying to put them informed about the question of artificial intelligence nowadays, but I also work with other teachers. And in the last years, been said about the importance of AI in education. And there is some ways or the way that we think about this is not a typical framework, but at least to put the different ways that we can address in terms of AI. And this is defined in three different approach. And it was defined by Wayne Holmes. And they are mainly three areas in terms of integrating or putting artificial intelligence in education. And these three different areas, and I will take a more deep approach in the next slides about this three different approach, are learning with AI. And here we are talking mainly about the teaching and learning process and how we can introduce some tools and platforms here. Then we have another area is about learning about AI. And here we are more on the focus of teaching young people about AI. But if we want to teach young people, we also need to teach the teachers, okay? So what approach are needed here so the subject of AI can be also integrated in terms of the curriculum. And the third area is about learning for AI. And we were talking about learning for AI. We are mainly thinking about how can we prepare our students so they are be able to live in the world that day by day we have more impacts of AI, positive impacts, negative impacts, challenge, concerns, and so on. As Teemu was saying, is the most important here is for individual to think critical about AI. So they have their own understanding in terms of AI. AI is just a tool, is a technical. So we should not be falling in terms of the technical, but we should be side by side. So in terms of AI in this particular area, we're talking about mainly about how to prepare the young generation to live in the AI world, if you can call it that. Okay, so these are the different, approach when we want to establish the way that we want to address AI in education. And now I will just go and address each of them in more particular. No, too deep, of course, because this is not our main goal here, but at least to give you some glimpse and some understandings about each of these approaches. So when we are talking about learning with AI, we have three subtopics. We are talking about system-facing AI. And here we are talking about the tools and platforms that can help the administrations, let's say, for example, in terms of admissions, timetables, learning analytics, and so on. So this is mainly on this subtopic. The other one is student-facing AI. And here we are looking at the tools and platforms that can help the student enhance their own learning. And there is lots of discussion around here. If the tools that are the platforms that are creating today, are they really helping the students, or they are mainly in terms of replicate old pedagogical strategies that are mainly isolating the students, somehow put it in front of a monitor with some headsets and just decide with a black box, machine learning algorithm, what should be the path of the students. Maybe this is not clear what we want. Okay, but this is a very interesting discussion also on this. And we also have, from the point of view of the teacher, okay, so what tools, what platforms could be developed in a way that can help the teacher provide a teaching quality in terms of the different aspects of the curriculum. And of course, there are tools that are developed here, and this is not something new. We have, for example, the ITS, Intelligent Teacher Systems, that came from decades ago, and so on. But today, what we can do with AI, maybe we can think about future tools, try to imagine, try to create them, try to develop them, tools that clear are put in terms of the students and their learning. And this could be, for example, this could be a very nice and interesting discussion. Also, why don't think about some kind of adaptable collaborative learning platforms when students and teachers can interact, and maybe other experts and AI can clear help in terms of this interaction that are established according to the learning styles of the students and so on. Another possibility will be for students to have some kind of AI learning companions that can be side by side and help them on their learning path. For teacher, for example, through AI teaching assistants that can help the teacher, okay? So this is something that according to the needs, and if you put in perspective in terms of the near future, of the needs for the students, and we know how this digital transformation is changed in terms of society, cultural, and also political, ecological, everything is being changed. So we can think, so with all this potential, what can I create to really help in terms of this, the different tools that can be built in terms of this particular area? So this is learning with AI. I talk also about the other two, but I just would like to leave you with a question for reflection when you are talking here about the teaching, the education, and we have lots of hype around this, okay? We have lots of people talking about this, and many people did don't have so much understanding in terms of education. Sometimes are these kind of big texts and talking about the replacing of teachers and so on. So maybe the main question will be what is will be the combination between the human and the artificial intelligence, some kind of augmented intelligence, and this kind putting in practical approach, so we can in the near future, when we hope in the very near future, to provide teaching of the very best quality. So in this particular approach, I think this should be the reflection. When you are talking about learning about AI, so here we are talking about how can we help prepare students and teachers to know about AI and elements of AI and building with AI, as Teemu was talking here, is a very interesting example that can be used in here. And teaching young people about AI is mainly in the perspective of using AI tools that they can use to create something, okay? When we are talking about teaching teachers about AI, is that we need to train the teachers so they are able to go to the classroom, okay, in the way that it can help the students use these different kinds of tools to be more creative, to boost in terms of their curiosity, to think about how can I pick up and in something and give value in terms of this. And in this way, using the different potentialities of AI. And of course, another area is about training tomorrow's AI engineers. And maybe this is something that we have to start to think about in high school and not only this for college or for higher education. So they have different perspectives in here. Some of the things that maybe we can think about here will be on this particular approach, how can we integrate in the curriculum things like related with data skills, AI ethics, and create and build it with AI, okay? And if Europe want to be on the forefront of this the development on AI, we need also to start looking in terms of what we call the high school and even in the other schools levels. So maybe here, in terms of thinking about some reflection, is we should not leave everything in this approach for higher education, but instead learning about AI and how to code with AI and using the AI tools should be integrated in the school curriculum. And this should be integrated and giving opportunities for every students that need and possible, who knows, in the future, they will join this challenge and very dynamic labor market ecosystem, okay? So this is in this particular perspective. Before I move on, because we agree to develop some activities during my talk, I would like you to challenge you, and the link will add on the Facebook chat. Try to create something by using AI, and this in this particular contest, I will challenge you to use DALL-E, and this is developed by the OpenAI, and they are very well known, maybe you heard about them, about these text models that they have been creating, this GPT-3, it was the last one. And if you want to take an opportunity to use, at the same time, create image from text, you just have to go to this link here, and I will just put here on my screen also this, so you can see, I think you can see, okay? So you just go to the link, and here you can see in the way that we can use AI and human interaction in the way that we can create very creative things on it, and you just have to go. Okay, there is different things that you can text experiment here. For example, I will just show you this one. Okay, you just have to go, and then you select and you change the sentence. Okay, for example, I can put a teapot. Okay, instead of an avocado, I can use, for example, a lotus root. Okay, instead here of imitating some kind like a glacier. Okay, so, and the main challenge here is that you create your own, okay, and then just take some screenshots, and then you can put that on the Facebook and share with all the participants on the MOOC. Okay, so this is just a challenge. As you are in terms of the this challenge, I will just go back to my presentation, okay? And as you know, you were asked to put some questions for me and for Teemu, of course, in this particular context of AI and education, and we just pick up two of them. And the first one, it was, what would be the best way to introduce AI to people that have socially contact with this field and they feel insecure with using digital tools? How can educators make the AI a more concrete term for young learners? I think that already some good examples was given here, for example, in terms of the elements of AI. But I think that the first important point here is don't feel insecure, okay? What is very important is to have the notion about the existence of AI, how AI is impact in our daily lives, how we will impact in the future, and it's important to develop this discussion with your students in the classroom, okay? So even for the young learners, and we normally we are talking about here developed technical approach and so on, but there are also some very interesting unplugged activities that you can discuss and put this as an issue to be discussed with your students on the classroom. I don't know, Teemu, if you would like to also to give some insights related with this question here, because I think is a very interesting question.
Yeah, that's a brilliant question. I think there's many good answers. I agree with you, Marco, that the important thing is to get rid of the fear and the feeling that this is sort of only for special types of people who are kind of natural born, you know, coders or technology oriented people. And the point about unplugged experiments or you know, games to play or something is also important, because not everybody is sort of so familiar with the devices. Even though we speak of the digital natives, I think that's really not the case. There's learners, even young kids who are not so familiar with digital devices. So we should sort of probably start from something familiar to them. Many of them have probably watched at least YouTube if they haven't sort of, you know, learned more about computing, but they, at least most kids, they use YouTube or Spotify or Netflix or something like that. And we could sort of point out that these systems are using AI to recommend music or films or whatever that we like. And then I always try to what I tend to do personally, in if I'm given let's say half an hour or more time, then I will always give an example of one kind of an AI algorithm. And of course, I will not show any code or anything complicated, but I will just show the so-called nearest neighbor method, which is really something that I can explain in 10 minutes. And then another 10 minutes I can spend showing how that would lead to similar recommendations, similar kind of similar things being recommended if you listen to them or if you purchase them online, you know, Amazon or whatever. So I would actually combine that sort of linking things to the familiar, something they have experience in using, and then opening some of the principles that are behind them to show that even a very, very simple method like the nearest neighbor method can result in something that actually looks like intelligent, or sort of looks like the system is intelligent. And then they will kind of say that, okay, well, now the kind of the magic is gone. It is actually, after all, just a very simple way of comparing like things and finding similar things and so on. And I've really gotten a lot of good sort of responses from this approach, and people can actually you know, digest that type of information quite nice.
Yes, sorry, Rihanna, please.
Yes. I just wanted to say that that's a great example. And we've had so many questions about the age of students, if they are too young to be introduced to AI. Mm-hmm. So thank you for your answers. Obviously, age is not a barrier, should not be a barrier for teaching AI. And it's never too early to start teaching AI. Also, maybe to relate a question about the school curriculum, do you think that AI should be a part of every school curriculum?
Yeah. In my opinion, we should at least take a look at it and try to understand clear how AI is impacting in terms of every aspect of society, as I was saying before. And I really consider that we need a curriculum. I don't want to call reformation or something like this, okay? But at least starting integrated, because if you look at different subjects, if you look at math, if you look at physics, geography and other, every aspect will be somehow impact about AI, okay? So in your future jobs, okay, the young generation, in even with us, okay? Nowadays we are using AI sometimes without we even have the notion that we are using AI. Maybe we have some kind of smart agents, algorithms that are taking decisions instead of us, okay? We just have to think about with Google when we are doing online search, that is some kind of AI behind it, okay? As Teemu was saying about these recommendation systems, Netflix, Amazon, and so on, okay? If you think about other situations, even they are being using. So why should not AI be put in terms of the school curriculum, okay? In different proposals, as I was saying here, maybe think about the different subjects, because we have to clearly understand what we need today to teach our students in the world that is so impacted in terms of these systems. It's not following the technology per se, okay? It's just to have in mind that the way that we think about, let's say, the labor market, for example, and the way that our lives were organized, it will change tremendously in the near future. So I clear agree, just to make my point that AI should be integrated in the school curriculums.
Yeah, I agree. It's just that, of course, we don't have to have a, like, you know, mathematics and you know, Finnish or English, and then AI. You know, it doesn't have to be a separate subject. It is much better to integrate it in the other subjects and think of it in terms of, let's say, like some sort of social science or history or art, and you know, anything. And of course, obviously, mathematics and things like that are good ways to sort of illustrate the use of mathematical concepts in very, very simple AI methods, such as the nearest neighbor method that I mentioned. And that can be fun. And I think young kids like preschool and younger, it, of course, the fun and the creativity are really important. important, and they can totally be compatible with AI or computing or programming or robotics and such things. And I think that's it's really, there's a lot of opportunity, and people should really embrace the opportunity to have fun with that with the kids. And I guess one of the questions, I took a look at some of the questions, and Ariana, I think you mentioned that, like, labor market change, how are we going to sort of prepare the students to the changes in the future, on what kind of jobs there are, or whether some jobs will be kind of disappearing due to automation. And that's a really difficult question. I have to say, I'm not an expert. I think, you know, economists and experts on the labor market will be able to perhaps better, you know, they're maybe better positioned to anticipate some of the changes. Of course, it's really hard to forecast. You know, nobody has a crystal ball. But still, you know, those who know the past probably are better prepared to anticipate the future. So I would probably listen to them. But still, I do believe that the change is going to be maybe slower, at least in the near future, than we maybe expect. It's not that entire jobs are likely to disappear. So for instance, if there are teachers out there who are wondering, oh, is my teacher job going to be automated by an AI system or a robot, I would probably sort of be very comfortable continuing working as a teacher and not being worried about that being automated. Because teaching, of course, is such a fundamentally human skill. It is so open-ended. It is really sort of not so much about routine. I think there's a few things that in teaching can be automated. And in language teaching, I think there's been nice examples, some apps, Duolingo or whatnot, where the repetitive pattern is the key to the learning. And if there's repetition, then AI sounds like something that, you know, sounds like something that you would actually rather let the AI automate or do instead of you sort of doing that repetitive, eventually boring work perhaps. So just to touch a little bit on that question, since that also seemed to be sort of raising some questions, I can't sort of guarantee anything, but I would not be all that worried looking into the past where the change has been slower than you know, was forecasted just, you know, in the previous past or the, you know.
Yeah.
So, or I don't know, Marco, if you sort of have any comment on how the job market is going to change, what jobs are going to be disappearing.
As you were saying, Teemu, we don't have a crystal ball. So it's impossible to predict anything on that area.
Yeah.
And we have so many different studies, even from the people that, as we are not experts on this particular area, and we have studies and research saying, okay, will be a big vanish of lot of jobs, and then we have another study say, no, that will be not the case. Maybe what will change is particular tasks on this kind of jobs, so you need to be prepared to working side by side maybe with these systems. And that's what you were saying, the human side in all of this. Everything that can be automated will be automated. Mm-hmm. Okay, we have no doubts about it. We just have to look in terms of history. First, the Industrial Revolution. Okay, we have the Luddites and say that all the jobs will disappear and so on. And what we are seeing is in each, technological development, we are seeing that new jobs are appearing and some jobs are being transformed and some jobs will disappear. Okay, mm-hmm. Now the speed and how it will happen, we clearly don't know. That some change will occur for sure. And I completely agree with you. Teaching is maybe the last profession or job in the world that will be automated, because learning and teaching is about emotions, is about social relationship and so on. So that's why I was saying that some of my concern is some tools and platforms are being developed with the stamp of AI and are not promoting all this social relationship and in terms of collaboration and so on. And they are isolating the students because we have this some kind of magic black box machine learning algorithm that will decide would be the path of the students. Okay, as this in terms of education is something that we have to be very pay attention in terms of that. Now the future, even today, I don't know. It's very difficult. That what we know is AI is having a big impact. Mm-hmm. And once again, as we were saying, should be for everyone. Okay, and everyone should reflect and should develop their own opinion. And for that to happen, change in society, they start on education. Okay, so that's why I think that the topic of AI should be integrated in the school.
Yes, to make teachers aware of what's going on, what's possible and what's impossible with AI. So yes. this is what we need to do. And that's why we are doing this MOOC and mm-hmm. also this webinar, and we talk about it. Okay, Marco, please go yes. on with it. Yes.
Okay. So I just was talking about this two approach. I will just mention the last one, and it's like make a resume about what we are talking here during this last minutes. It's about also teaching young people about AI and bringing AI to the school curriculum, as Teemu was saying. Okay, of course, maybe you can have some subjects from some students on high school that would like to learn to create with AI and so on, but is not creating a separate subject. Okay, so in geography, in chemistry, in maths, and so on, social science, philosophy, and all these kinds of subjects, how AI is impacting. On arts, we can create, we use AI to create music, to create image, and so on. So it's very important. This is also some kind of mindset. And in this particular here, maybe some of the things that we should be discussing in terms of the schools and with the students would be about this AI literacy, what are the skills and the competences, the different disruptions in terms of economical, cultural, and so on. But I think the main focus should be about human values, okay? And we are living in this tremendous area of technological development, digital technological development, where being human should be valued as never before. So I think this is a very important particular thing that we also should be working with our students. So, and these were the three different areas when, of course, in terms of this framework, when we are talking about how to integrate AI and in education. And here we also have the question when you are talking about this particular area on AI in education, that is, what is the purpose of teaching the knowledge and skills that AI systems can do and all too often much better than humans can? Okay, so this is something that we also need to reflect, and this is also a bigger discussion in terms of education. Maybe nowadays, in due to the all this transformation, maybe we have to rethink and reinvent the educational systems in terms of these critical skills and competence that we have been talking for a very long time. We said that these are the skills or competence for the 21st century, but we are on the three decade of the 21st century. Okay, so creativity, collaboration, curiosity, critical thinking, communication, value judgments, and social and emotional learning. Okay, everything interconnected in what we were saying. So this were just to give you an idea on how we can think about put AI and education. And we prepare another activity for you, okay? And in this particular case is to use AI where you can just pick up a phrase and have someone saying that phrase. And this phrase, and I think you agree with me, Teemu, lots of discussions around here, okay? How these systems can be used, should there be used? What are their damage potentials in terms of deep fakes and fake news, okay? Should we trust what we are seeing in front of us? Maybe for the first time, we are getting this very blurred situation between the digital and the logic. So it's not just telling students, okay, you have this tool, We have to discuss what are all the potentials related with this kind of tools. So if you want to try it, you just have to go to this and there will be ad on the chat and maybe try something, I don't know, in the context of this MOOC, asking, let's say, Sir David Attenborough just to say something on their accent. This is an amazing course about artificial intelligence and education. I just love it. Okay. We also can say Elements of AI is an amazing course, and it's with no doubt, just give it a try. So you just have to go to vo.codes. Okay. And just give it a try. If you want to add this to the Facebook to share with other participants, they don't create a link, but you are able to save in the WAV format, and then you can upload it, for example, to SoundCloud, and then just share this. But I think this is a very interesting tool in the way to discuss all the things around the potentials of AI, the good ones and also the bad ones. The same is not applying also in terms of deepfakes, not only in terms of audio, but also in terms of video, okay? And we are living, let's say, times where it is very important to educate our students in terms of this. So I think that this could be an interesting also activity. Okay, we also, when you are exploring this activity, there was another question that was posted by one of the participants on the dot storming. And they ask, where would you set a measure and acceptable limit when using AI? Teemu, I don't know if you want to start with this one. I think it's also a very interesting question here.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure. Maybe I didn't get the gist of the question. I think the acceptable limits of using AI. It's really not so much about whether it is AI, but rather whether it is, for instance, accessing people's private data. So sometimes the limits are drawn not by the methods, but the, like, for instance, the data sources. So I don't want my private data to be processed in any way unless I give consent to that. And it doesn't matter if it's AI or whatever, computing, or even if it's like a person doing it. So I think it really depends on the use case, and not even so much about whether it is AI, but whether the end result and the impact of the application is acceptable or not. So I would sort of say that this is really sort of not so much about AI. Maybe I missed the question and it meant something else instead. I'm not sure.
Yes, the question here is not so the tool that is being using, but mainly in terms of, as you were mentioned, in terms of the data that it is using, and what are the main goals in terms of using any kind of technology. For example, in terms of AI, we have also lots of discussion about automatic weapons, okay, that are driven. I'm not an expert on this area. I just read some things about it. And there is a lot of discussion if this should be developed or not, and what are the ethics things around here. But I agree with you also, because we have some kind of ethical reference, okay? So it's not only about AI and any different technology that is being using that somehow has to fit on this kind of reference. We can think, for example, about the free laws of robotics from Asimov, okay? And maybe give some contextualization and in here. But at this moment, what we really need to know is not AI that is leading. Okay, we don't have this kind of AI nowadays, this AGI, yeah. Artificial General Intelligence, okay? And we never know if they will happen or not. Also very interesting discussions around this, okay? This could be a topic for other discussion here. Is the human that is leading, okay? Yeah. So is the human responsible? We cannot say, oh, so sorry, I was not expecting this, it was AI that did this. At least I think, and Teemu, you're working on that area. I think we cannot start in blaming AI for things that are happening right now.
Definitely not. I think one of the sort of cornerstones of responsible use of AI is accountability. That you can't blame the system, you can't hide behind the system. Somebody needs to be accountable if something goes wrong and there's harm. And I think that's one of the sort of key principles, definitely, in any application of AI, especially when it comes to people's safety.
Yes, and that's also a question on our question board. Who will be responsible for the mistakes that the AI might make? So who is responsible?
Yeah, I guess there's a short answer, then there's a really long answer. So I won't go to the really long answer. I'll just give the short answer that it depends on what is agreed about it. It's usually like we have to make a contract. It's similar to me maybe selling, maybe if I would be a car manufacturer and I would sell a car, then there's some sort of rules about liability. If I have omitted safety checks on the car, for instance, and then the car breaks and somebody's hurt, then I can be held responsible. But if the car is if the car kind of fits the specification and I deliver it to the customer, and then the customer something happens, then I'm not going to be liable. And that's that really depends on the contract usually, and that needs to be sort of settled in court. But of course, the principle is that it's never the computer. Never, you know, it would not help anything to identify a system as the responsible party, because we can't penalize, we can't put the system in jail, or we can't, maybe unplug it. But you know, that's not how it works. It has to be humans or perhaps companies. That's of course like legal person can be a company, but it. There's an even longer answer.
I absolutely agree. Yeah. And if I may refer to this activity that our viewers are now doing with vocals, so it is also something that can be used for bad purposes, for evil, you use someone else's voice. And it's not a high-end technology, something that our students can use on TikTok. It's very easy to swap faces, make videos with. So I think we teachers need to bring that to the classroom and make students aware of what they can do and what harm they can cause by irresponsible use of AI. So I think even though this tool is a deep fake, as they say, we should be aware of it and use it in the classroom to make students aware of what can happen.
Yeah, and then there's that there are also sort of quite complicated legal issues related to the intellectual property that is created by such systems. So sometimes the one who created the system might be entitled to, let's say, copyright or other intellectual property rights, or sometimes the people whose data, like in this case, Sir David Attenborough's voice was used to train the system. So sometimes your voice or your photographs or your other, you know, maybe you do paintings or something, maybe that data is protected. And then, of course, it might lead to a violation of somebody's intellectual property. And then sometimes the user has a creative contribution. So it's really also complicated there. But one thing I just can't help mentioning and pointing out, that it's to me, it's a bit exaggerated, the issue of deep fakes kind of eroding our trust in things. And my point is that, of course, I could write on my keyboard that, President Joe Biden has declared war on Finland. And that text, you can't tell it apart from the real text. I mean, of course, you know, it might be written in different words. If somebody declares war, they probably just don't state it as bluntly as that. But anyways, text is extremely easy to fabricate, right? And it still hasn't eroded our trust in text. Why? Well, because we trust the source. And the simple solution for the deepfake issue and the erosion of trust due to deepfake is also that you have to learn to trust the source more than the content, or you have to sort of, you know, make a decision about whether this is trustworthy based on whether you just saw it on a random Facebook page or YouTube or whatever, or whether you actually saw it in the front page of your, you know, daily newspaper that you would totally probably trust in most countries. So, yes. So in that sense, it's perhaps not such a, you know, red alert in terms of things being completely messed up with these deepfakes.
Yeah, I completely agree with you, and I'm glad you mentioned this, because I really think that we need to be aware, as again, as I said, but use it in the classroom. Don't just decide not to pay any attention to it, because it can be used for evil. But
I'm sorry. Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, Teemu. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say that it's an example where the explaining how deep fakes can be misleading, but then again, how to get beyond that and actually sort of find the source and then sort of decide whether to trust it or not. That same principle, of course, applies in general when you're teaching media literacy. So here's somebody asked in different subjects how you can showcase or how you can incorporate AI content in these subjects. So if you're teaching, let's say, media literacy, or, you know, maybe you'd be teaching English or Finnish or whatever, and that contains some parts of media criticism or literacy, then you can incorporate AI as an example of misleading content and help the students identify the ways to you know, tell them whether they are to be trusted or not. So that's just one example where you could just plug in easily some AI-related content.
Yes. Excellent idea. Thanks for your answer to this question. Yes, Marco, please go ahead.
Yes. I would just say we can make here like a metaphor between these tools nowadays, and they will be more and more easily to use, and they will get better and better and better. But you can think also, for example, on Photoshop, okay? Mm-hmm. Just also can pick up images and completely change, okay? Yeah. That's been using for a long time. Once again, is it what talking about is the importance of the human reflection and the critical human of thinking, right? And what Teemu was saying, you have to fact check. More and more you have to fact check and to see what are the sources, okay? And not believe everything that is put in front of you. Just because you've just been listening or seeing a video of some people is talking about something, and you know as easy as to create fake videos, you have to see what is the source, where it is coming from. And you have to put all these things in terms of context. Will Joe Biden declare war on Finland? But why? What they want from Finland, okay? And the same thing on Portugal and so on. So once again, is working, giving examples to our students, putting them to be aware, putting them to be more reflective and reflective, okay? And then put all these things on context. So I think it's very easy for any of the subjects just to pick up some in terms of some examples and use it as examples to discuss all these kind of things.
Yeah. And okay. There was another question I think I noticed on how you could then, so we discussed young children, and I think somebody brought up the question then, like, if you turn it around, how would you illustrate AI to senior citizens that are maybe not so familiar with, you know, maybe they don't use YouTube or Netflix or Spotify. I'm sure many do, you know, obviously, but not sort of so keen to find out how they work or so on. But I think the example that Marco showed with the voice, this kind of voice generation, another thing that came to my mind that might, you know, again, old people are a very, very diverse group, and there, you know, many of them are professionals in something, you know, dentists or you know, teachers for that matter. But overall, I thought that something that might be generally probably high interest to elderly people might be to take old photographs, and then I was playing around myself online just, you know, a week or two ago, with the system that we upload an old photograph. Like it's one of the black and white photographs that we have hanging in the kitchen wall. We don't even know who this person is, but we just all found it in one sort of relative's old house when we visited, and now it's on the kitchen wall, hanging there. And we took this photograph. I took a photo with my cell phone, uploaded it, and in 10 or 15 seconds, it generated this video where this person suddenly came to life, and she was like looking around and smiling a bit, and it was really it was really something that came so close when the photograph suddenly starts moving their head and smiling. And I think that might be something that many older people who maybe have lost their loved ones some of them might of course dislike that very much, but for some it might be quite interesting as an illustration of what is now possible that wasn't maybe possible even a year ago.
Yes, that's very, very good examples in terms of using this. And in terms of AI, if nowadays we are just using a smartphone for sure that we are using some kind of these kinds of AI and different perspectives and so on. And this is a very interesting example about being able somehow to recover old memories and so on. In terms of this use of AI, and you know, even with the younger ones, this is happening in the same way. I would just to give you a short example. You know, Google Lens. Okay, mm-hmm. You just point something, and you very easily can give you information about this. And one of these days, I was at home, and I was trying to find a place where the place was, and I was not be able, and my daughter just came to me and say, Daddy, just use Google Lens. And she just put the lens on that, and oh, this here, okay. So there are so many examples that we can use and help, and even in education, in other contexts that we have to be aware. And once again, that with this very, very change pace that is very, very at the high speed in terms of change, we are always being surprised with different kinds of tools. So that's, once again, that is very important to have AI to be discussed and integrated in terms of technologies in all these different, let's say, perspectives, not only from the technical perspective. Okay, mm-hmm. This is more deeper than just a technical issue.
Okay. Thank you, Marco. And you also have some suggestions of tools that teachers can use, right?
Yes, maybe some of them were already added in terms of the MOOC, okay? And this is, for example, in terms of learning about AI, and there is lots of different things that you can use for the younger ones and even for the older ones that you can be using here, for example. As Teemu already mentioned, elements of AI. We have also machine learning for kids. We can use IBM Watson platform and do different kinds of activities. We have the AI project with Google and so on. So there is with the autonomous vehicles from Auto AI, for example. And of course, you have all different kinds of things that you can just experiment and see how they can be used and integrated in terms of the classroom and education. This is about learning about AI, okay? Learning for AI, also there is lots of things, and of course we have to see the age of the students, the context, okay? You have to be very critical in terms of how we will use this and how we will integrate this, okay? Of course, because we don't have this curriculum, this is just, let's say, if the student, the teacher will and consider that is important, they can bring this to the classroom, of course. So this is just some suggestions, but there is a lot of contents that are being producing today that you can then be used in terms of these different aspects. Okay, I think I'm finished here because I have the next slide about the questions.
Questions, yes. Okay. I think we've already answered all of these questions. Mm-hmm. Tommaso, if I may ask you if there are any urgent questions that need to be answered that were shared by viewers on Facebook, I have some questions here in the chat on Zoom, but we have already answered those. So Tommaso, can
thank
you
please? Thank you, Arianna. Yes, there's no other questions that need an urgent answers. I think many are looking for great examples of tools and materials like the one that Marco just shared. So, but feel free then afterwards to go through the chat because there's many very interesting comments and possibly nice conversation to be continued afterwards.
Thank you, Tommaso. Okay, then what can I say at the end? But thank you so much for joining me tonight. Marco and Teemu, maybe one last message for the participants of our AI Basic for Schools MOOC.
I just want to congratulate people for their courage and their initiative in jumping on into such an interesting and timely topic. And I think it is certainly going to be a good choice for the future and future-proofing each other, ourselves and children is extremely valuable. And I just wish people the best of luck and strength to cope through the pandemic and through all the kind of difficulties that came with it, and to continue their best work to help kids learn better and grown-ups too.
Thank you so much. And Marco?
Yes, in terms of AI, don't be afraid about the name in terms of artificial intelligence, as you are being able to see during this MOOC and also the other reference that we have given here as elements of AI and other ones. You don't need to be an expert or have this knowledge in terms of backgrounds of math and all this kind of thing. Just start to explore in terms of AI and bring AI and into the classroom. As you can see, there is lots of examples, lots of research, there's lots of communities. So from this MOOC, for example, I think that just grew up here a very interesting learning community where we can support each other and work with each other and share the examples in terms of integrating this. And also we as teachers, we are also open to learn with our students, and maybe some of them also know some kind of this tool. What is very important is not to keep this away as we have been trying to do with some other different technologies, okay? So we need to bring this in terms of the classroom and starting to discuss and starting to reflect and maybe, who knows, create or building something around AI. And I think that is the most important thing about this. Okay, give it a try. We are not talking about something that is magical or something like this, okay? This is one more technology, and it has been around for 17 years or more, since the 50 in the 20th century, okay? And we have this big boom in terms of artificial intelligence. So we just have to use it in the best way that we can imagine. And for that, we need to educate the young generation. So I think that is clearly the most important.
I agree, and I think we should never stop learning, and that's why we are all here. We learn from each other. There are so many things, so many new things that need to be learned, and if we are together, then we can help each other. And so don't stop me now. So it's just like in our first webinar, when we ended the webinar with some music, we are going to do it today too. And today we are going to sing along with Freddie Mercury. Teemu, do you want to try? Because Marco said he wouldn't rather.
Oh my God, you didn't warn me. This is horrible. Nightmare. But I will bite the bullet. What do I need to do?
So
I don't, Marco, I don't think you will hear my sound because I don't know if I choose to put my computer
sound. Okay, you can try
during the presentation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I will just see if this is
working. So the point is, yes, the point is that you can choose a song by the Queen, so the Queen, the Freddie Mercury, and then you can sing along. So this is kind of a karaoke. You get the words on the screen and you sing along, and then the AI will calculate how close you are to Freddie Mercury. I must I tried it.
Oh my God.
I was 10%.
10%. Oh, I was 32.
Okay. I would be minus 20.
I will just click start singing, but I don't know if the sound, we will hear the sound or not. Just let me know.
Yes.
Because if needed, I can just start sharing and then
but, share. But what we can do, we can invite our viewers on Facebook, the participants of the MOOC to...
Are you listening now?
No, we can't. I can't hear it, but it's very easy. It's very easy.
We can
ask our participants, you know, to give it a try after this webinar, and then share if they're there. If they're there, they can share the recording because you get the recording. Yes, now we can hear it.
You can start. Yes. You can start, Ariane.
No, Teemu, you said you want to start.
I'm terrible on this.
Okay, let's do it together.
So, let's wait for the...
Stop me now.
Don't stop me.
Having a good time.
Okay. Do you want to see the score? No.
Don't stop me now.
Okay. I think the algorithm is too benevolent. Okay.
So what's the score? 50%. 17. Oh.
Yes. It was your voice, Ariana.
Okay, please share it. Or Teemu's, your voice.
It might have been the fact that I played the original from Spotify, just from my
phone. Okay.
I cheated.
Yes, you did. Okay, that's the way you cheated with the algorithms of AI.
Yes.
Another very important thing to teach your students about.
Yeah. 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 Cheating. Yeah. It's a very good skill. Let's not get into that. We'll get in trouble.
Yeah, yeah. But don't forget to have fun with AI. There are so many things, nice things that we can do with our family or with our students.
Exactly.
No doubts about it. No doubts. Completely agree with you, Ariane.
Yeah. So let's hope that there will be even more Freddie Mercury songs on Facebook and scores. And so thank you so much. It's been a huge pleasure to have you here, and I'm sure your expertise will definitely be a win for our teachers to use AI and implement it in the classroom.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much.
We'll hear great things from the students, I'm sure, once they get a hang of it, and they'll amaze us.
No doubt.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And bye-bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Alison, you can stop the recording now.
Okay.
We are not live.
Thank you. Thank you so much.